present, man is the master. Metal is his slave. But new discoveries on Earth and on a dangerously close planet nearby suggest that we could face a threat from monsters made of metal, naturally evolving machine-like entities, creatures who don't just tear up our assumptions about the very nature of life itself, but who could challenge and defeat us for control of our planet.
We often assume that aliens would be interested in us, but these might just be interested in our planet's hot core.
January 2018, Great Britain. A scientist builds a machine with almost godlike powers. It is designed to create life, but not as we know it.
This machine we built to explore the origin of life and to make artificial life forms.
By making inorganic cells, the machine brings together different chemical compounds.
We put them onto the surface of the planet, if you like, and let them interact with one another. Then we're looking for droplets that literally burst into life. Within a few seconds, they'll start doing really strange things as they explore more of their environment. So there you go, this one starts, it's not bursting around spontaneously.
The cells in the dishes act like they're living, but it's not life as we know it.
These are completely dead. We're just looking at how inorganic cells can take on lifelike properties and fool us into thinking it's alive. And then at some point, we're going to be able to not tell the difference, and then maybe it is alive. But I basically think we now know how to make life in the lab. Within the next decade, we will have made some very odd-looking life forms.
The life forms Cronin is working on are like nothing found on Earth.
In my lab, we've been trying to make primitive life forms based on an iron oxide.
Could life exist based on metal instead of carbon?
If we manage to make life in the lab, that will allow us to change our entire set of parameters on how we would look for life in the universe.
Bizarre as it seems, Cronin's and other experiments are not only persuading scientists that inorganic life is possible, they are already speculating what that life might look like and where in the universe we might find it already existing. Their research has led them to look again at a nearby star.
55 Cancri is a sun-like star. It's just a little bit smaller and a little bit less massive than our sun.
It's a star that is only 40 light years away, which is basically the equivalent of being in our astronomical backyard.
Around this nearby sun, they discover an exoplanet of a type astronomers call a super-Earth.
There's this planet called Janssen. It's about twice the diameter of Earth and about eight times as massive.
It's like Earth, but on steroids.
Super-Earths are good candidates for finding life because they're going to have a lot of interesting elements on them. A lot of heat and gravity to drag these materials together so the processes that give rise to biology can start.
For life forms made from rock or metal to evolve, geological, chemical, and climatic conditions would have to be just right.
Astronomers have used Hubble Space Telescope to look at Janssen and look at its atmosphere.
It seems like Janssen does have an atmosphere, and it actually might be kind of thick, and it might be kind of Earth-like, with a lot of nitrogen and some oxygen and maybe even some water.
Like Earth, but in one important way, very different.
If you were standing on the surface of planet Janssen, the sun in the sky would appear 60 times bigger, and it would be 3,600 times brighter than our sun.
Janssen is very, very hot. It's something like 4,000 degrees Fahrenheit.
That is just far and beyond anything we can even imagine.
For humans, this super-Earth is a vision of fiery damnation.
You would see liquid metal precipitating like rain out of the atmosphere. You would be buffeted by incredibly high-speed winds coming from every direction. It would be like visiting Dante's version of hell. The conditions on Janssen mean instant death for anything that we would understand currently as life.
Life on Earth is centered on DNA, on proteins being arranged in different orders. And it's all kind of delicate. If you put too much heat into it, those chains of proteins fall apart, and life becomes next to impossible.
We know of the potential for inorganic life from laboratory tests, but such a different form of life would break all the rules of biology as we know them. How would such creatures look, or think, or behave, even on a chemical level? Sci-fi writers have already imagined such fluid metal monsters in the Terminator movies.
Because of the nature of the place that they live, it would be almost impossible for any component of them to be solid. It would be very difficult to imagine them having anything resembling a skeleton. So, if anything, they'd be more like amorphous blobs, perhaps like the T-1000.
Liquid metal organisms living in the fiery lakes of Janssen, growing red hot and able to shapeshift into any form they want.
Do you take a more spherical shape to conserve energy, to have as little surface area compared to your internals as possible? Do you take a more elongated shape for predatory activities?
Such liquid metal beings would have evolved, as we have evolved, to adapt and to survive the conditions around them.
The idea that they move around by manipulating magnetic fields within their own body would potentially mean they could do so with objects around them as well.
Is it impossible that after billions of years on this fiery super Earth, evolution will have produced creatures as advanced or more advanced than on our own cold, wet Earth?
I think if they're good at working metal, they would be able to potentially make metal structures in ways that we're not as used to and not as skilled at. But they'd be used to working with things in their molten state and would have had to have developed the techniques for doing so. They would be taking advantage of the tremendous amount of energy pouring in from their star.
Having mastered the elements on their home world, would they then look, as we do, to venture into space?
The beings on Janssen, if these metallic liquid T-1000s do exist down there, would look at Earth and see an absolute hellscape. They would all freeze to death.
But if the Jansenites can travel through the bone-chilling vacuum of space to get here, then they will have the technology to overcome anything the Earth can throw at them.
Their spaceships will obviously emulate the environment on their planets.
They would have to keep those temperatures and the pressures sufficient to keep themselves together and to keep themselves from solidifying.
What's more, there are places on the Earth where the liquid metal Jansenites might feel almost at home.
If they were looking at visiting Earth, volcanoes might be a reasonable place to go.
It is no doubt a coincidence that many reports of unexplained aerial phenomenon happen close to volcanoes, whose temperatures can reach to 2200 degrees Fahrenheit.
There's string reporting of UFO reports in different volcanoes throughout the world. Are they visitors from Janssen or a similar type planet?
They'd have to go fairly deep into our mantle before they got to a spot where they would consider it to be real beach-like for them.
Earth's molten outer core, 1,800 miles inside the planet, has temperatures of 4,000 degrees Fahrenheit, the same as Janssen's scorching hot surface. The liquid metal aliens could be swimming in the molten ocean beneath our feet right now, unbeknownst to us.
I would imagine if these aliens turned up, it would be entirely bizarre. Would we tell the difference between an inorganic life form visiting and a meteorite going through the Earth's atmosphere really hot? I don't know.
Just as we might not recognize them, they might not even see us as life forms. Just strange clumps of organic matter scattered over the thin crust of our planet.
I find it very difficult to believe that we could interact with them in any meaningful way.
If they decided to wipe their new world clean, we may not have any way of asking them to stop.